like to start this final afternoon of this conference. And I know that several of you, the participants, are already leaving. So before waiting for the end of the event, I would like to thank very much the people who helped us to make this possible. I would like to thank very much the support from Foundation to make this event possible, and particularly through Hijin and also Nisea, who will be sharing our session now. And I think the support we got from the Academy of Sciences, which accepted to host this event and provide us a very strong support, and then the individual support, starting first of all with Micheline, without whom we couldn't really do this. I mean, she was the soul behind all the organization, all the contacts with everybody, so she was very crucial in making this possible. And then the people from the Academy, and of course, Fernando Verissimo, and Fernanda Walter, and Gabriela, and Pedro Dantas, who worked in the graphic design, the team in communications, which provided the live links with through the internet and the site, Elisa and Clarice, and Samil, and the people in the computer science, Sanderson and Alan, and the Sonia and Lucelena in the secretariat, and then the support of Diego, Carmen, and Maria. So this is a group of the Academy. They were very helpful providing all this work for us. And so I think we were able to have a very successful event, which I hope we will be able to bear fruits in terms of following up with other activities similar to this one. Without further comment, I would like to ask Nisea to chair the session. Nisea Frey is the head of Ford Foundation office in Brazil today, but she was the rector of the State University of Rio de Janeiro. She was minister
in Women Affairs in
the Brazilian government. So she's a very distinguished and well-known scholar and activist of feminine causes and social policies. So we're very glad to have her here. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Simon. I'm very honored of chairing this panel, and mainly because I'm between two distinguished academics and two distinguished professors that studies models and how to improve higher education in our countries. It's a pleasure for me to be here for different reasons. And one of them is that we are hosting this seminar in collaboration with our colleagues from the office of Ford Foundation in China. Heijin, my colleague, is here, my colleague from the office of China. And we are lucky because this seminar would be held in China. And for different reasons, we brought this seminar to Brazil, and we got the opportunity to be in contact with this diversity that we can see in this audience and this richness of thoughts and perspectives. So I will immediately give the floor to Professor Naumar Monteiro de Almeida Filho. Naumar doesn't need the introduction. He is one of most unquiet and a challenging person that I met in the university environment. And after being a rector during 8 years of the Federal University of Bahia, what is a challenge and a big task. He is now, since 2012, creating and discussing new ways of configuring a new model of university. So the presence of Naumar is perfect to open this discussion that I hope we can hear Naumar, and after this hear our colleague, and then open the discussion with all the participants. Please, Naumar, you have the floor.
If I may, if the chair allows me, I'd like to stand up and speak and walk a little bit, because I think the presentation will be more lively, I hope. I, first of all, have to thank Professor Simon for the invitation, but also for the suggestion of topic. Institutional differentiation of universities in Brazil, stressing two dichotomies. One is teaching versus research, and the other is public versus private. And what I try to do is to deal a little bit with the argument that these are not dichotomies. They should be terms of dialectical processes that appear to the analysis as opposing terms. And we should start from an overall economic and political context by stressing that among all these issues and factors, we do have knowledge as a main asset in the contemporary world. And we should say that it is accompanied by an epistemological context in which several vectors of change are increasing, and they do define present times. Time and space has been compressed to a limit, and we've talked this morning about the future and the possibilities of a prediction, but time is future project, it's not present time anymore. Space is boundaryless, but this is perhaps the main characteristic or main definition of these times. And so we could say that we are within an eco-logic with time-space fluid, boundaries as fuzzy as possible, shapes liquid, and then I selected a piece of art. That's the cubism of our times, round cubism, if we could say that. But I also found a mural in the old University of Bahia, made in 2000, that I think also represents the other side of contemporary times, which is diversity, represented in this case by the several colors, but also networking, complexity. I could say that some of these terms have been used widely, but the idea is to say that by the times the universe was invented, and by the times the universe was redefined, the world was different. So we could remember the trivium three ways, the quadrivium, and now we are facing perhaps a pentavium. These are the competencies that are required for not only intellectual survival, but definitively the daily life survival of fully aware citizens, digital literacy, communication skills, not only the lingua madre, but also the lingua franca, research capabilities, the building of reasoning as provided, developed, and promoted for science is being applied in every sphere of life. Teaching competences. More and more people are urged to teach in order to learn. And this other topic, this fifth way, which is listening, is something that is not too much valuable to the common sense, but more and more has become more important to not only articulate the other ways, but also as a way in itself. So the issue is not research against teaching, but research and learning, which means that not teaching as a kind of a one-way approach, but the interaction of different actors in the process of learning. My point is that we should seek for research learning universities and not research universities against teaching universities. This is a quick summary about Brazil. These are the updated population estimates. More than 200 million people. The elementary school populations, 28 million, 30 million. High school grads, 4 million. And this is the population between 18 and 30 years old, 25 million. I'm taking this age group up to 30, because in our reality, 24 is not a limit for proneness for tertiary education. And this is the last census published, the higher education population in 2013, 7.5 million. And this is not a detail, but I try to represent the map of Brazil, not north to south, but east to west, by showing that the country may, and perhaps is in the process of finding a new axis in terms of geopolitics. And this is a picture of Brazil nowadays. Immense poverty, wealthiness, and separated normally by urban parks. This is Salvador. And another picture. And the urban areas in Brazil are like that. Extremely segregated, to the point that when you reach the interface, huge walls separating wealthiness from the real poor conditions of the majority of the population. Our social context at this point is social inclusion, but more marked inclusion, environmental challenges, violence and intolerance. And there is indeed poverty reduction, but, and this is somewhat paradoxical, increasing social inequalities, economic inequality reducing and increasing social inequality. This is a summary of the higher education attendance rates from 2003 up to 2012, no doubt, increasing the attendance rates. But this is the private share, and this is the public share. Of course, the proportion is about the same, but the rate of increase for the private sector is much bigger than the public sector. And this is the evolution of the composition of the public sector by showing that what really grew at this point was the federal system. After 2006, it got really a speed for a federal program that promoted the growth, the expansion of higher education in the public sector. But the question is, how does such a trend articulate in terms of the equity-inequity dynamics? Is that we have a political system that is reproduced by an extremely unfair, regressive tax system. Perhaps Brazil is the world champion in this topic, too. Social inequity. But what makes this reproducible in a historical point of view is the perversion in education. And it's very easy to understand that. We do have a social minority which receives fiscal incentive for several things, but the two biggest fiscal incentives are for health and education. So this social minority gets better quality education in private high schools, but with a tax redemption, which means that it's the state that renounces the tax and this quality education allows the future generations of this social minority to get better quality education in public universities, and they pay no tuitions or fees. Of course, this produces more employability, higher income, political capital, social value that helps the reproduction cycle to, for the next generation, the guarantee that the kids from this social minority will stay in that social minority. But this cycle is supported by a second cycle that reproduces the position, the social position of the poor majority, which finances the state. Because proportionally, poor people in Brazil pay more tax than rich people. The IPEA, a central office of the federal government, made a calculation. Families with lower than three minimum wages pay 56% of the income in taxes. And families that have more than 20 minimum wages pay 17% of their income in taxes. And so this poor majority that finance the state, they have access for low-quality public education, which allows to those who are able to overcome the high school level, the secondary level, to get to higher education of lower quality and paid, because they do not succeed in general to compete for the places in public universities that are not in big number. They are very short, very elitist. And this, of course, in spite of getting access to tertiary education, it's an education that leads to lower income, unemployment in terms of crisis, and social exclusion that reproduces the cycle. Of course, public policies, such as a quota system, affirmative action, that became a law for federal universities and was supported by the Supreme Court, takes a proportion of students that graduate from secondary school into these public universities. And also another public policy is the two programs. One is a kind of a financing of the tuition and fees, and the ProUni, which is a kind of scholarship that for some people, not for all, produces the coverage of the expenses by subsidies from the state. And of course, there is a third program, which is called ReUni, that operated from 2008 until 2012, that expanded the places, the slots in public universities of the federal system. Of course, these public policies help the structures to remain perverse. And they do succeed in putting some of the next generation for social mobility very limited to the point that the whole structure is not touched by that. So for the university in Brazil, I would say that we have some challenges. The first one is to deconstruct tertiary education as a factor of social exclusion, because in Brazil, the universities are active instruments, tools for social exclusion. Secondly, we do need to tackle the challenge of systemically integrate the university into the social field of education, because in Brazil, universities, especially public ones, are alienated from the general social field of education. Third, to decolonize the Brazilian university, overcoming concepts of excellence that are not absolute excellence. They are indeed to the service of an elitist concept of the university. And fourth, to recreate the university as a key player in models of development, especially leading the university in Brazil for a more territorial a trend instead of looking forward some type of a global perspective. My hypothesis is that we had a university reform in 2008. For some reason, in 1968, we had a university reform by the military government. And this one was restricted to the federal system. Expansion of public slots, opening courses at night. There was a really significant budget recovery, faculty recruitment, and all of these united in a program that was called ReUni, which means a program for restructuring the federal system of tertiary education. We did have, among the goals of the ReUni, affirmative action, but most universities did not present proposals in that direction, which forced the Supreme Court to rule on this matter. There was also a movement towards recreation of graduate teaching in Brazil, but a few universities used the opportunity to do that. And so I'd say that this is the section of this reform that it's still due. And we did have a curriculum reengineering in some universities, implementing higher or tertiary education in cycles. A cycle of general education, which could be propedeutics for a second cycle, of professional and academic education, and the graduate education as a third cycle. The rationale is this one. Today in Brazil, and this is sometimes difficult to explain to fellow colleagues from abroad, the people that have access to the university, they have to choose the course before entering the university, because they apply for a national exam or a specific entrance exam for each of the careers. So actually, even if they come to the most prestigious USP, for instance, or the young, very dynamic Unicamp, they do not enter USP or Unicamp. They enter the Faculty of Law, the Faculty of Medicine, the Institute of Psychology, the School of Engineering, and so they have these tracks that they follow. But the composition of such tracks is that in green, we have contents that are shared by all of these tracks. In these colors, we have common contents to different areas of knowledge, such as all these red is what is common to computation, the several types of engineering, and so on and so forth. And what is specific, which is in blue in this graph, is what is exclusive for that training. And so what happened is that would make much more sense, because the rest of the world has already done that, to concentrate in the beginning what is common to all, at a second phase what is common to different areas, and leaving for a further stage what is exclusive, in order for the students enter into the university first and being recognized for what they accomplish and not for what has been preset to as an entrance way to the university. So what is in green is what is called general education everywhere. But this doesn't happen here in Brazil. What is in this second stage are the major areas of knowledge, such as arts, sciences, humanities. And in Brazil, we did separate health for not only for the social need, the urgent social need, but also because that represents an enormous share of the slots in a university. So getting into the university, general education, and the grand area education, that's what we call in Brazil the interdisciplinary bachelor. And the second cycle should be the professional or academic training specific. And so the entry into the university, not in faculties or schools, that provide a general education in which the student do not need yet to choose the career, complemented by an area such as health, for instance, but promoting the exchange among areas, exposing those who have chosen one of these areas to the other ones. Someone could enter for a health profession, trying to go to medicine, for instance, but in the process would have all this interface with the humanities and should be a hybrid training. That could lead someone to another possibility of a exit, or to public health, which is my field, in the interface to sciences, that someone could enter thinking that they would take this career but would slide to this other, or even to a totally different approach in terms of a flexible system, such as depicted in this graph, is totally contradictory to what the Brazilian university is at this moment, to a point that if someone takes the exam, enters a course in mechanical engineering, and in the second semester decides that, well, it would be better to go to electrical engineering, according to the Brazilian rigid system, that young fellow or that girl would need to get out of the university and take another exam because the system is rigid, it's totally predicted, totally inflexible. So, the conceptual structure of this idea of the interdisciplinary bachelor is that all students share the general education. So they choose one of the big green areas, and then in specific training centers, could be faculties, schools, institutes, they would go to concentration areas that would lead and facilitate the training. The good news is that 20 rounds of the Brazilian public universities have some type of innovative curriculum experiments based on that structure, on the, a much more flexible and modular structure. Starting with the Universidade Federal do ABC, the Federal University of ABC, which was an outlier in Professor Renato's talk yesterday. But my hypothesis is that it's not an outlier because of being only technological and also because of being small. It's because the curriculum structure is prone to this type of innovation. The second one is the University of Bahia, Federal University of Bahia, the one I was president for 8 years. We implemented a wider repertoire of the interdisciplinary bachelors. Other universities, including Unicamp, with a short cycle, but very, very interesting, which is called the Profis. In my university, my current university, is the Federal University of Southern Bahia, we offer only the entry using that open modular flexible system. And so I will take a few minutes to introduce you as a case of it's not an experiment because it's being well grounded on the regional, in the territory. That's what I'm going to demonstrate. This is the south of Bahia. Bahia is a state in the northeast. The capital city is Salvador. And the south of Bahia is this region. Contrasts with the other areas of the region because of the forest. We do have the Atlantic forest, still well represented in the territory. 48 municipalities, 1.5 million inhabitants, 330,000 students in elementary schools, 75,000 students in high school, and the tertiary education population is 17,000 students, mostly in private institutions. Only 4,500 in public institutions, with only 1,200 slots being offered by state universities. There were no offer for federal public university training in the region. When I was president of UFBA, we took a very, very strong expansion trend into the hinterland of the state. And we learned a lot of lessons. Difficulties for retention, recruitment and retention of teachers. Models of management that were taught in Brasilia and have nothing to do with the deep reality in the hinterland. Conventional curricula. But this is what is most interesting, to the worst definition of interesting. The universities, public universities, in the interior of Brazil, they are exclusionary of the native youth to the extent that there are courses, especially those open for more competitive careers, that have no students that belong to the territory surrounding the institution. So we started by defining values. We actually wrote a chart of foundation of the institution. And the other Brazilian universities have more statutes, bylaws, and so, but they do not have a chart of foundation. We did. And these are the four values that we agreed: committed to social integration, to basic education, to regional development, to academic excellence. Of course, these are values, words, principles, but help to generate a proposal. That's very simple. We refused the semester, which is a kind of a fiction that happens in Brazil. The academic year starts March 15th and ends June 15th. It starts again on August 20th and ends December 15th, which means that public institutions in Brazil, they are not operating 5.5 months in a year of 12 months, which means a total misuse of the public facilities for higher education. So we implemented the quota system. There are two other universities in Brazil with the quota system. One is the Federal University of ABC, and the other is the Federal University of the Integration Luso-Afro-Brazilian. These are the two that use the quota system. We introduce a general education undergraduate structure, a flexible curricula, a wide territorial coverage that I will show you what that means, an organization structure very, very light. This is the curriculum. We have three campi, and I'm going to show you on the map. But we also have a network of small community colleges in municipalities that have above 20,000 inhabitants. Students can choose to go straight into interdisciplinary bachelors, such as the other university that I mentioned, but also they have the choice of not choosing, which means get into the university and make the choice well-informed within the university. So they can choose ABI, which is an acronym for Área Básica de Ingresso, which means basic area of entry. In the first cycle that lasts 3 years, the mobility, the internal mobility total, every quarter we have a call for change. So the students can choose changing. The second cycle is professional training. And the third cycle is postgraduate. And of course, this structure has general education as the core, as the affiliation to the institution as a step. How the students get into there? We do use the NA, which is the national equivalent to SAT, with a quota of 55% for poor peasants, black Indians, into the interdisciplinary bachelors, as I've shown, health, sciences, arts, or humanities, but on the network, the quota is 85%. In the law says minimum of 50%. So we read the law and put to the maximum. But what happened is that in the small municipalities, there are no private schools, no private high schools. And so, in fact, we do have 100% poor peasants, black and Indians in the university. And they get into this first cycle to the general education core curriculum. And this is the example for sciences, in which the first quarter, they have sensitivity and listening. This is it's not a discipline, because it is impossible to learn sensitivity and listening by disciplinary approach. These are exercises of lecture of the world, apprehension of reality. They also have language as a political tool. They do have an affiliation to the universe. These are this is a moment of two different actors that encounter, the student and the teacher. Math and space. And of course, if they have chosen sciences, the field of sciences, knowledges and practices. And we do have the field of arts, knowledge and practice, the field of humanities, the field of health, the field of education. The second quarter, the other, it's like a tracks. And of course, universe of society is a whole track. English language, which, by the way, is a requirement for reaching the second cycle for most of the course. But we have Portuguese, our mother tongue, math and computing, and the students have training in coding. And if they have come to the university for the field of sciences, they do have to pay to what we call complementary cultures, two courses on arts and two courses on humanities. If they've come for arts, they would have to take two courses on science and two courses in humanities. If they've come for humanities, the other two areas. With the possibility of, if they decide to change, they use sciences as a complementary culture, and then rewrite their program according to the new choice. And of course, the track in terms of a Portuguese language in sciences, it's a workshop for Portuguese language in sciences, and mathematics and computational perspectives in sciences, but this also happens, it's offered in arts, humanities, and so on and so forth. This is the representation, but also a very strong incentive for taking all of that in education. And I show you afterwards what is the consequence. After finishing the general education and having chosen the degree for interdisciplinary teaching, they choose between five options. These are the options that the Brazilian secondary education is organized. Languages, math and computing, natural science, human sciences, and we include arts and technologies, which is missing in the general orientation. What happened here? Oh, yes. Well, I'm just proceeding by showing that they can finish this first cycle, proceed to, finishing the general formation, the general education, they can choose a technological exit, not with us, but with the Federal Institutes of Technology, that there are two of them very active in the area. The general education is certified, a certificate of general education, and the first 3 years is a degree, a bachelor in sciences, arts, humanities, or health. And each of these choices is propedeutics to a second cycle professional training, being sciences for engineering, biological sciences, arts, design, and so on and so forth, humanities, and health. And this is a third certificate of the module that has been. And this is the structure laid down on the territory. This is the headquarters of the university. It's a campus called Jorge Amado. We have implemented four Colégios Universitários, which is the name of the community college. If the student decide to take a technological profession, such as one of the engineerings, they can finish their training in this network. But if they decide to go to a law or health or medicine, in this campus, we offer the 4 bachelors, but not the second cycle specifically. In order to preserve the idea of a critical mass, we have concentrated, for instance, the training in humanities in the campus of Porto Seguro, where we do have three other colégios, or they can go to Teixeira de Freitas, where the health training is concentrated, and where we do have already 2 community colleges. This is the map of the region with the 3 campuses implemented, 8 community colleges, and this is the planning around Itabuna, around Porto Seguro, and around Teixeira de Freitas. But we also have a very important indigenous population, so we are going to open 3 Indian community colleges, and 1 in 1 quilombo. I don't know how familiar you are with this. It's a settlement of runaway slaves that is being for isolation being preserved. We do have one here. It's called Elvesia, and also in Assentamento, the most important in the area. Assentamento is the name we give to settlements of the landless movement peasants. Digital technologies, and we are lucky to have the crossing north-south, the region, the major branch of the National Research Network backbone. We implemented a network. All 1/2 of our investment is being in technology, and we have total capability, despite the poor prediction of the Ministry of Education that doubted that we would be able to implement the digital coverage in the area. Okay. All students receive a laptop. This is a group in the Colégio Universitário Bicaraí. I will just skip this, but if someone gets interested, this is the perfect facility for digital teaching. And I will skip this one too. No. I got a note that I must finish, but I think this should be presented because it's the integration of the cycles. We have what we call active learning groups. Every resident, which is someone taking courses, third cycle courses, they are responsible for 2 of these active learning groups. A student that is finishing is responsible for a colleague in the middle, and that one is responsible for the supervision of mentoring, someone that, who is starting, and also those from the first cycle. And that implies a very efficient system, because we have only from our staff of our faculty, the supervisors and the mediators, providing a ratio student-teacher that is impossible using the conventional system. This is the headquarters. This is the campus in Porto Seguro, the campus in Teixeira de Freitas, and we just recycled installations, facilities that were already available there. I will skip this one. This one, just to show that we also accredit as teacher Masters of Traditional Arts and Crafts. This person, this sir, he is capable of building boats. Naval engineers do not know how to build boats. This person, he is capable of recognizing trees, and botanists are not capable of recognizing trees to the same extent that this is a class. This is one of our classrooms, by the way. The students there. He is the son of a mateiro. That's the name. That someone who lives in the trees. I will skip this one. Also this one, but, and I'm sorry I take 2 minutes to show that. Yesterday we are talking about stakeholders and how the Brazilian university missed this point, and which differentiates the Brazilian university from the other BRIC universities. It's because we have no structure for including the stakeholders in the academic management. And we do have a social strategic council, which task is to promote this social forum, to advise the university global policies and develop plans composed by sponsors, partners, stakeholders, representative of 13 social segments, elected those representatives by a social forum. We, by the way, last week we finished the process. Students, Indian students, but she's a faculty, she's a Peruvian, Quechua, and came to Bahia. Our students, and people do not know that in the south of Bahia, 20%, 23% of the population is Pataxó. This is part of the social forum. He's a master quilombola, a marvelous social scientist. These are the capitalists of the region that came to the... Here are they electing their students, Pataxó. She is a pajé. She is a herbalist. Teachers, secondary education teachers, future students, because we do have a segment of secondary students that are represented in the council, peasants voting, quilombolas, that sir that I presented. She was elected by the quilombola as the leader, Tidinha. This is the meeting, the closing plenary session. That's me talking to them again. The chief, the eldest Pataxó, Pataxó, I'll explain later if someone is interested. These are the representatives aligned. Of course, institutional representatives too. The council, 25 people. And I just finished with trying to oppose a conservative approach, which is a small number of self-selected public research universities would classify themselves as world-class institutions, but alienated from a non-system of teaching institutions for vocational and professional training. That's the scenario that sometimes it seems that it's being proposed in Brazil. What is the drawback of this? It's basically the differentiation of this as a national system will produce political hierarchy and quality gradients, and will increase inequality among institutions and regions. By leaving to non-research tertiary education to the private sector or to a second level public sector. And the other drawback is that the education system as a whole will not be articulated to this network of world-class universities. What I would proposed as a progressive, more progressive approach, is to face the challenge of creating research and learning universities integrated internally and articulated into the public education systems oriented for social integration with territorial coverage. And the question is, key question, is it feasible to create such a learning university articulated, well socially integrated with territorial coverage, and at the same time guided by high quality knowledge production referenced internationally? That's a key question. We have now 200 faculty and almost 2,000 students. Last week is part of the team is a faculty of our university. So up to now, I would say that all signs, humbly stated, is that it's feasible to have such a project with high-quality faculty. This is a group of Yale students that have come to learn in the Atlantic Forest, about the Atlantic Forest, because they knew about that away from there. This is a prospect of the Edinburgh University calling students to come to visit our university. And so my final message, or should be an assumption, but also a hope, is that the dilemma, massivity versus excellence, can be solved by four factors. One, intensive use of technology, multiplying the teaching capacity of the faculty, integrating research into learning and not separating research, some institutions, learning others, or teaching other institutions, pedagogical strategies based on solidarity, and a systemic planning based on participation. So we have used it to achieve some of our goals, a strategic planning tool, outcome network mapping. You can recognize the four basic values of the institutions, and also reflection about the reality, and that's me on our coastal area, very absorbed by thinking, what should I do to attract faculty to this new university? And we found some interesting solutions. One of them is to show this slide to this audience in the hope that some of you would come there to help us build this institution.
Thanks, Professor Nauma. I think we will have a lot of questions coming from the audience. So I immediately give the floor to Professor Kirti Menon from the University of South Africa. I told you that Professor Naumar will instigate you, and I'm sure that Professor Kirti will do the same thing. So we will have a lot to discuss after this session.
Can you hear me? No?
Yeah. Just wait a minute.
Yes? Okay, good afternoon, everyone. The purpose of my session was to discuss differentiation. Within the South African context, one has to understand differentiation quite differently, if one may say. Our system, compared to the Brazilian system, is comparatively small. We have just 1 million students currently, as of 2015, in the higher education system, and a not very strong or robust vocational college system. But what is quite interesting about the South African higher education system is that since 1994, one could almost view it as a laboratory where experiments in policy development have taken place. So it has been a very, very interesting place for policy analysts, but not so successful in terms of the length of time it has taken for policies to be dreamed of, gazetted, agreed upon as policies, and then actually implemented. So the issue of differentiation in the South African higher education system is one which has an evil past. It has an evil past because it was rooted in apartheid. However, post-1994, there was an assumption that the system would change and would transform and all would be well very quickly. However, 20 years later, we have understood that the change for differentiated higher education systems, if we even can agree on what we mean by differentiated, for what purpose, and what kind of a system does the South African economy and society requires, if there was such an agreement, then I think that we would have made progress quite quickly. However, post-1994, we started off with 36 universities. All 36 of these universities had different histories rooted in race or language, rooted geographically either in traditionally white areas, traditionally African areas, traditionally colored areas. And what has become very, very clear for policy analysts is that changing the structures and changing that which has been allowed to grow in a particular direction is not an easy task. I myself have 14 years in the higher education government system and have understood quite bitterly that your dreams can get crushed quite quickly. So to give you an example, a very important, and I believe my speaker has referred to it in a different context, an academic policy for a country which determines what kind of qualifications you offer, what is the length of the degree, etc., has taken from the year 2000. I served on the first task team. It was gazetted in the year 2014, finally. It is still to be implemented. The length of time for policy development has been so long that one almost forgets why one began the process. And I think that that's quite an important issue to throw into the mix when one begins to talk about differentiation. So now that we've talked about the dismantling of apartheid, which actually was not dismantled and is not dismantled, it's just removed in terms of government gazettes, constitutions, but the reality on the ground, very similar to the reality of Brazil, which you have been referring to, of marginalized communities, the perversities of the system, where the poor can only attend particular universities because of proximity geographically, because of their poor marks, because of differentiated admission rules, because of affordability. These are all factors that still play out in the higher education system in South Africa. So if we agree that 1994 was a critical year for South Africa, we can agree on that, and the second critical juncture was, of course, the restructuring of higher education. And again, one suffered from the seduction of believing that if one actually changed things on paper, there would be real change. So between the years 2000 and 2005, we had what we call restructuring of higher education, which was a very painful death of some institutions and the birth of new institutions. So from a system which had traditional universities and what we called technicons, which is similar to polytechnics, we moved into three new types of universities, but reduced the overall number of universities from 36 to 23. And then we had a frantic state of birth, if one can call that quick, quick giving birth to institutions. We've had three pop up in the last 2 years. So we now have 26 universities in the country. And these are what we call comprehensives, universities of technology, and traditional universities. However, what I would like to point out is that none of these structural changes were accompanied by the required policy changes. So there was no particular direction given as to what should be a comprehensive, what exactly is a university of technology, and what is a traditional university within the context of South Africa, but also locating South Africa within global and international trends. The second, which is probably the nail that actually makes you bleed, is our funding formula for the public higher education system. We have a very, very weak private higher education system. We can't even count the numbers in our participation rates for higher education. They operate mainly in the fields of business or management or commerce or the what we call in South Africa, in government circles, the skins. In other words, beauty, skincare, somatology, etc. And that is the extent of the operation, with a minimal number of institutions operating with very tiny numbers in the field of theology, but linked to particular churches, etc. But again, if I return to the nail in the coffin, the nail in the coffin for differentiation has been our funding formula. Because our funding formula actually points to, if you are a responsible council, or what we call a vice chancellor of a university, the only route you could sensibly follow in order to be financially sustainable and not be in the media for running out of funds or being unable to pay your human resources bill is to follow the route of the traditional university. There are no incentives for a university becoming a good undergraduate university. There are no incentives that are particularly in place for offering good professional vocational education, because what is quite critical in international circles for good vocational education is the placement of your students into industry. That segment remains unfunded by the state and therefore becomes the responsibility of the universities. So what has happened is that 20 years later, what we have is a situation where even if a university has been named as a comprehensive or as a university of technology or as a traditional, the aspirations of all these universities are to become a traditional university, because being a traditional university in the current policy regime of South Africa means that you will eventually become financially sustainable. So the debate on what is differentiation in the South African higher education system is one that is bedeviled by the absence of policy, the arrival of policy without the accompanying policy instruments. So you could change a policy on paper, but still continue to fund as per the old norms. So there is no incentive for change. There is no reward for truly becoming a comprehensive. You actually will get penalized in terms of the amount of subsidy you receive from the state. So having portrayed quite a damning picture of differentiation, that 20 years later there has been very little movement in terms of a real differentiation, what is quite clear is that the policy to implementation lag, and I would like to believe that this might be the case in all countries. Please nod if this is the case. I would hate it to be only the South African context. But the delay between understanding the direction and agreeing on the direction to go and actual implementation has had serious implications for the higher education system. It has altered the direction that we assumed we were going to be taking. So, unlike a system that was going to double itself within 5 years, we did nothing of that kind. The dream was to grow our system in science, engineering, and technology. That also has not happened. The third dream was to increase the number of students in professional and vocational programs with a prospect for employment, of course. That also has suffered. So in this mix, the department finally published a paper, a gazette, which is still, believe it or not, 20 years later, a discussion paper. This was released a year ago and is expected to shape our understanding of a differentiated higher education system. But a key question that I think has to be answered, and that is, if you present a paper on differentiation, you have universities that are deeply entrenched with 5-year, 20-year plans already mapped and charted out, deep-rooted systems and structures and qualification profiles. How do you turn that ship around without looking for another 20 years for the ship to turn? So, just a few slides. I call it an incomplete journey because I suffer from some variety of pessimism in assuming that the journey is definitely not at an end. And I have outlined this But it is quite critical because, you see, we know this history off by heart now. But these are the turning points. And you will see that in 1996, when policy really began, new policy making in the new democracy, from 96 to 2015, we are still talking about a differentiated higher education system with no action barring the restructuring and an academic policy which emerged. So you will see that there is a serious deficit in the way in which the policy regulatory environment has unfolded. Differentiation has been driven by policy absence. In the absence of policy, institutions have chosen and made choices to grow and to follow incentives which are in place. Funding has driven differentiation. Every university's mission statement is to grow their postgraduate profiles because you will get rewarded in terms of this government subsidy, and to increase the number of students in science, engineering, and technology, even if the region you are located does not actually call for that, even if you do not have the competency in that, but the funding formula favors science, engineering, and technology. Therefore, if you're a wise council setting out the agenda for your university, you will follow that route. There are no rewards for undergraduate teaching. The academic policy in higher education in South Africa does not significantly speak to what should a qualification look like for a traditional university versus a comprehensive versus a university of technology. There are odd sentences here and there which refer to practical application of theory, etc., but not sufficient direction for a university to adopt, absorb, and change its structure. In 2014, we have a policy on differentiation. I said no action because what is the value of a policy or a discussion paper if the accompanying instruments to steer the system in a particular direction are absent? So we can understand differentiation to be a process in which the diversity of a system increases. From 1994, we've had this discussion. One could almost replay, I promise you I haven't done it, but one could almost put on the same PowerPoint presentation because that's how much movement there has been. We've talked about mission differentiation, performance-based differentiation, self-differentiation, program differentiation. And the reasons have been the needs of the students, labor, market, social mobility, effectiveness, etc. And the question that does arise at this juncture is, do universities drive the direction of differentiation themselves, or does government have to take the lead? But if government is the primary funder, and if funding drives the university's agenda, then we are back to square one in that the universities will not differentiate because the system and the policy regime will not favor differentiation. The purposes is, of course, these are fairly standard, and these emerge from the policy, different policy papers that have been going around. I think we have had more than 20 iterations of this kind of discussion, but it does not translate into further. This is our regulatory environment, and of course we have the complexity of, and I don't know whether other countries in BRICS are the same, but we have a new structure that will be regulating and overseeing almost every year a new structure, a new kid on the block to send you in a particular direction, etc. But these can be quite distracting in terms of the direction that the country has to be taking. This is just a demonstration of all the acronyms that live in the higher education system. That's the Department of Health. I'm not going to test you on this, but it's the Department of Health that sends you in a particular direction if you are operating in the field of health. The Department of Science and Technology that has particular agendas in higher education. But the point of the slide is that none of these articulate with each other. So science, Department of Fisheries and Forestry, Department of Social Development, Trade and Industry, what we call the CETAs, which are sectoral authorities, none of this comes into one universal framework that can chart the direction, but yet they play a role on determining the vision, mission, strategic priorities, the size and shape of a university. And PQM, I think that's a very South African term, is your program qualification mix, what kinds of qualifications you actually offer. Our higher education system, I put this slide just to let you have one thought, that the drive to science and technology is one that might be, again, an incomplete journey. Because if you look at our performance statistics in the final exit year of schooling, you will see that the percentage of students eligible for access into higher education, into science programs, is not growing. In fact, it's on the decline. In other words, students are making choices. But it is, again, about a dislocation of our school system from the higher education system. It is, as one of the speakers yesterday referred to, the low investment in the school system resulting in poor schooling resulting in a big impact on higher education and an inability to achieve these targets. This is our worldview. As you will see, that there has been a growth in science, engineering, and technology. What I didn't put here is a slide which shows you the number of graduates that have been produced, because that picture will tell you a very different story. Because for every 100 students that enter the system, only 33 make it into second year. So we shed a significant percentage at each year. So the graduation statistics are quite poor. This is the final slide, but it does point to where the system is aiming to grow. And the question, of course, this slide is presented very often as being a very positive slide, that we would have achieved a participation rate of 20% by the year 2013. We haven't. We've only achieved 17% at the last count. It'll probably drop down because the student numbers for 2015 have been low across the system of first-time entering students. So instead of showing, if we were here next year, I would be showing you a decline in growth in our higher education system. So instead of this upward spiral, we would be having a little bit of a descent, because the student numbers have gone down. And once again, this is about graduates finding employment, affordability of higher education, the kinds of programs that are on offer, the number of spaces that are available, and whether these students emerging out of the schools present with the right subject combinations and symbols in order to access higher education. So the road to differentiation for the South African environment is a bleak one. It's bleak because it has differentiated itself in a very haphazard, spontaneous way, directed by the whims and fancies of individual institutions. Thank you.
Wow, I think we had a fantastic description of the dilemmas of the South Africa university system. And there are, of course, some commonalities between the dilemmas that the Brazilian system face with the South African system, with the South African system. I will open the floor for the audience, but the first I only wanna to emphasize one thing that I think it's important in both presentations, the issue of inequality and how the university system can fight against inequality, help to reduce inequality, or how the university system can be a reproductor of inequality in both countries. And the issue of differentiation perhaps can be an indicator of how inequality operates amongst the university system. The other thing that I want to stress here is that in Brazil, as well as in South Africa, the system is very siloed. So, but to break the silos, we need not only policies that target university, but general policies in society. So, we need to tackle the determinants of the social inequality in society, to tackle the determinants of inequality within the university system. We have some minutes to questions. A very provocative panel. So first, Professor Simon. Maria Helena. Davi, Luiz Davidovich.
Yeah, may I? Well, I think that I'm very fascinated with this experiment of having this interdisciplinary schools in Brazil and breaking this kind of very traditional way of students entering directly the professional degrees. So I think it's a very interesting experiment, and I think it's a very something worthwhile following very attentively. At the same time, I have very doubtful about many things. One of them, I have argued for many years that you need to differentiate research-intensive institutions and teaching-intensive institutions. And since we didn't do that in Brazil, we have legislation in Brazil say that all institutions should be research-intensive. The consequence that research is very concentrated in a few institutions, and the rest of the system is neglected because you don't have, since you don't admit that institutions can be teaching on, you don't have policies for teaching. You just have policies for excellence in terms of traditional research. But what I don't believe is that you can do research in your institution the way it's designed. You can mention someone who published something in Nature, but this doesn't tell you anything. That person, he is isolated, he doesn't have colleagues in his institution, he doesn't have graduate students, he doesn't have high quality students working with him, and he will just forget what he did if he just stayed there. You need to do research. I mean, what is research? And that's the main question. If you say all professors, everybody in higher education should read and do research and question things, and the student should be involved, that's fine. But that's part of education. You should start it in kindergarten. But when you talk about research in universities, you talk about professional research, people who write in the best, who work at the frontier of knowledge. And this is only some people can do in some institutions. So if you don't recognize that and you work from that premise, I think you are making a mistake. I just wanted to make this question, and I have one question for you. You mentioned that you select students through the NM, the National Assessment for Secondary Education. This is something which in Brazil was created a few years ago. Existed in the 90s, but then it was transformed. It became a kind of national entrance examination for higher education. You have something like 6 million applicants disputing 200,000 places in public universities, something like that. And it's so extremely selective. Although you divide these students among those who are in the quota system and those who are not, they are competitive both, because both of them are extremely competitive. So the question is, what is the level of the students entering your institutions on the NM? How many candidates per place you have? Is something that, are you recruiting at the top? Are you recruiting at the bottom? And which kind of students are you getting?
Maria Helena. Kirti.
Kirti. For you, Kirti. I'm intrigued with your disappointment about a diversification of institutions in South Africa. Because when I read the chapter written by Professor Michael Cross, I understood that during the apartheid era, you did have a binary system, traditional universities and the technicons. And then with the post-apartheid new vision, you would have a single system, not fragmented into many authorities. So a single one with three types of institutions. The traditional that already existed, the technological, which in my, when I said that was coming from the technicons, and the comprehensive that would do both. I asked someone and I read somewhere that would do both. So it's not that. And then I also read that the Afrikaners institutions, universities, they moved quickly to becoming entrepreneurial institutions. They moved to, you have an economic macro framework called GEAR, G-E-A-R. It's very, well, fiscal sensitive policy. And it was an incentive for institutions to get their own money, and I read that there was this move from. So I want you to explain to me, because in my impression, you did have things happening, and apparently things are happening, but they are happening spontaneously, not controlled or guided by the government. Is it bad, completely bad? I don't know, maybe.
So, Luis.
I have some two questions actually to Naumar. You know, I've heard before about this universe. I think it's an amazing experiment, and I do have some doubts about some aspects of it. But I'll leave the comments to the end. Just the two questions. First, How is the interconnection between the community colleges and the headquarters? I imagine, so in how far go the community colleges? Do they have only the general education level? Do they go to the second level in which you divide into four teams? After they, suppose they finish with a degree, this community college, what happens then if they want to get into some specialized profession? Do they have to go to the headquarters? And in this case, is there a selection process or everybody can go there? So that's the first question about the structure of this community college and headquarters. Second question, you know, you have these concursos, these contests for professors that come from everywhere. And of course, usually they are used to a very different system of teaching. How do they adapt to this kind of system? And the comment I have is that, you know, I see that among the professional choices, they are very much connected to the region, actually, right? It's engineering associated to the regional problems. And I imagine that in support of diversity, universities from other regions may have some completely different structure as well. And I would imagine that that's needed for the country, because I do think that we need also some global standards which come not only by looking at the regional thing, which is important, but also by connecting to the frontiers of knowledge in the world. That's important for Brazil, for any country as well, to have to be in the frontiers of knowledge, not only for practical reasons. And I don't think that the market is the only thing that should define it, but for the culture and the knowledge of the population. We should be in touch with what is being done with the Higgs boson as well of how can we perfect our agriculture. So, and that comes with the diversity, and I think it's related to the questions raised by Simon.
Thank you very much. Oh, first of all, I would like to thank all the organizing committee for this seminar and the participants, because we are used to discuss quality university in terms of research and papers and staff curricula. And here we have a rare chance to discuss teaching and learning in university, which I think very important. Well, the question goes like, we have had a number of initiatives in Brazil for establishing a university fairly similar to what Professor Naumar has described here. We can easily go back to 1960 and University of Brasilia that has many features that are similar to this initiative. And well, it's a sequence of failures. The question is, do you really believe time has come for that? Thank you.
Thank you. It's very, very simple, and that's a new, let's say, innovative curriculum. What happened to the disciplines? You know, talking about knowledge structure, you know, Malka Young, a strong knowledge. What happened to the disciplines?
It's really a supplement to the previous question. The structure that you're describing is actually very similar to the York University curriculum in the 1970s, and I'll be happy to tell you why we moved away from it.
The ENEM, the best indicator is not the number of students, candidates, in terms of competition, is it's two scores. One is the cutoff score, which is the one that there are no students below that. And the other is the average score. We have for the interdisciplinary bachelor in health a score that is above 700, which means that the students could go into a medical course in many universities. 645 is the average for humanities and sciences, and arts is around 600, which means that those students that they would succeed in getting into conventional universities. We have really tried to understand what happened, and our conclusion is that the territorial exclusion for remote areas in the hinterland is stronger than the social economic exclusion, which means that even students that would have the potential would not have the circumstances to get out of the isolation of geographic but also social. We are now in this, I will take the second question. We are just now finishing the selection after the general education. The students, they have what we call the CRFG, which is the Coeficiente de Rendimento da Formação Geral. It's the general education performance coefficient, which is the average of the grades that they have. And we use that as a sign for, as an index for the internal mobility. They can choose 5 different options, and they are selected according to the performance. And what is interesting is that everybody was somewhat concerned that all students would tend to go to medicine. That didn't happen. And 56% of them chose for the interdisciplinary teaching degrees, which means that is a very realistic approach to labor market in the small count, in the small municipalities in the countryside. Selection, if they have chosen the interdisciplinary bachelor, they would have to move to the headquarters, because that's where the courses, labs are concentrated. But if they choose the teaching degrees, they can stay in the community college. So it's, and we have organized it in order to have more incentives for them to stay. But if they decide not to proceed at this moment, the certificate is valid for 5 years, so they can return to the university and pick it up by the after the point that they have started. Selection of faculty. We had to change the system. We do not use the classical competition. We implemented a system that is divided into 3 steps. The first one is a general examination that uses a digital form. So the candidate do not need to move to the place where the contest is. And so we had selection in Brasília, in São Paulo, in Rio, in Salvador, and in Itabuna. And only the 3 best classified are invited to present the documents for the CV, the prova de títulos. And the candidate choose the 5 best titles they have. So they present what they think is their 5 best production. And this is very, very reasonable, because we do not use those huge boxes of documents that the committees, the examining committees, are normally used to. And then finally, the 3rd step is for every place, the 2 best classified candidates. So they are invited to come and present lectures in classes. But we never use sorteos or random assignment of anything. This is irrational. And the idea is that every candidate choose what they are the best, the topic that they think they are the best. Well, actually, we have a very good evaluation of that. The 99.5% of our faculty are PhD, which is equivalent only to Federal do ABC. No other federal university has more than 85% of PhD. And I think that that's a good start. We had the last contest, we had last competition, we had 400 candidates for 29 places. And we selected them using that step-down approach. The profile, of course, it's there is a function for the Strategic Social Council. And one of them is to help the university decide what is to offer. But we are fully aware that the university regionalized does not mean that it is isolated from the network. So we have already agreements with universities in Brazil and abroad. So the undergraduate student would finish their second cycle course in the other university. And that started with the Federal do ABC, because we do not need to have the engineering of energy that they have the best in the country, or the nuclear engineering. We would never need that there. But our the student that gets the degree in sciences in our university, Bachelor of Science, they would go to Federal do ABC. But Federal do ABC will never have a good botany course or a good forest engineering, because they don't have forests at the ABC. And so their graduates would come there, and so in a kind of a exchange basis, we can easily form a network in the whole country for undergraduate students. And the same is happening already with foreign universities. No other university in Brazil, except some of these, would be able to have a graduate, an undergraduate, ready to go to a foreign university. That's one of the failures of the Science Without Borders. Our students are going to undergraduate courses in other universities, but they come back, there is no equivalence of whatsoever they did there. And finally, political failure. The first attempt for this design was during the Vargas dictatorship. The second attempt was during the military dictatorship. Our bet is that we are not in a dictatorship or in never more, so we have good chance of success. What happened to the disciplines? They are there and waiting, disciplined for their role, because the point is, where is the interdisciplinary more useful for learning? And our position is that many universities decide to go interdisciplinary only for postgraduate and graduate courses. And our approach is that this would be too late, because then you would have interdisciplinarity defined as the sum of disciplines and not the integrated articulation of them. And how to articulate? Problem-based learning. That's the answer.
Agreeing what they should be offering, but not putting the incentives. So in the last month, for example, there have been at least four universities that are under either some intervention or the other, and the root cause is actual financial sustainability or corruption in some cases. But quite aligned to that is that if you look at what they are offering, it is directionless. Some of the institutions have not been able to think through what does it mean to be a comprehensive university, because there are no guidelines.
The only guideline that is there for you is that you can offer a mix. Yes, but it's not as simple as that. Yes, but the difference is that over the last few years, you will see that comprehensive universities are moving towards becoming traditional universities. So the concept of a comprehensive itself holds itself for interrogation.
Okay. Thanks, Professor Kirst. Now we will have a break, and then we will come back for the last panel. Many thanks to you all.